The citizens of McPherson, Kansas take pride in their community. Nothing brings the people together like their passion for basketball.
I believe it's a religion. I mean, the old saying is that when a child is born at the hospital, there's a basketball placed in his or her crib.
McPherson families go to games wearing red clothes to show support for the local McPherson Bullpups basketball team. There's no question about it. Basketball is the heartbeat of McPherson. The community's love for the sport of basketball started in a humble gymnasium in the middle of McPherson, Kansas. In the early 1930s, a hometown basketball team would fill this building with 1,200 cheering fans. The McPherson Globe Refiners were able to follow their dream to the 1936 Olympics in Berlin.
So I guess we can go back in history, go back in time to middle of Kansas, 1930, and there was a great deal of oil discovered in the Canton oil fields in McPherson County, Kansas.
Globe had built a refinery in 1933 with the purpose of taking advantage of and purchasing the growing supply of crude oil in this immediate area. There was just a glut of oil, and refineries were needed to refine the crude into products.
The sports page and the following of sports teams was like in any American era, something that Americans did. It was a good pastime. It was good from an entertainment value, and probably the hottest new sport at the time was the 40 or 45 year old game of basketball.
Well, in 1933, the Globe Refinery started a team. What they started doing was the first year, 1933-34, was an industrial league, and they went around to different towns in the area and played. It wasn't until 1934 and 35 when they joined the AAU, and that's when Gene Johnson came in and became their coach.
Family is a big thing in our family. Family was a big thing in my dad's family. Gene and Dad talked all the time about what could they do better and why, and how could they do it. And Gene had been a player, and Dad was the player that Gene was using to try to establish these procedures that he thought were better than anybody else's. Gene wanted to do well and be recognized, and my dad loved playing basketball. That's a pretty good combination. Uncle Gene is an interesting person. He had a strong opinion of himself, and he was not bashful about expressing his opinions to other coaches, other referees, other players, or any innocent bystander along the way.
So I felt sure that my type of game would go ahead and develop, because the other game was slow and draggy, and it wasn't exciting at all. All teams now play that type of basketball that we originated.
So what were these innovative theories? They were around full court zone pressure. This was a Gene Johnson initiative, is his invention. There's also fast breaking. Instead of walking the ball up the court, the players would go as fast as they could. This developed into a style of play known as firehouse or fire department basketball, because it was much faster paced than traditional basketball.
So, you know, that's kind of the background and work ethic that he came from and that he grew up with. And he liked to have fun, but boy, when it came time to work, you better have your working shoes on, because they were going to get it done.
What happened at that point was what we now know were world-class basketball players were assembled in McPherson, Kansas to play for the Globe Oil Refinery. When they weren't playing basketball, they had regular shift jobs at the refinery doing a variety of jobs in a hot and smelly environment.
Well, my dad was born in a town in southeast Nebraska. Both sets of his grandparents were German immigrants. He wore a size 17 shoe, and his sleeve length was 39. In fact, when he was hospitalized in Colorado Springs, Lucille Johnson told me that she made him a pair of pajamas and it took 7.5 yards of fabric.
The home games were played in the old convention hall, just a cracker box compared to the modern gymnasiums of today. I can recall, before the ceiling was put in, that the fans literally hung from the rafters to see games. 1,200 to 1,400 fans would jam into that little building.
Gene Johnson, I think, had a pretty good idea that his team would make it and get to the Olympic trials, which would be held later in the year. That would be after the AAU championships in 1936. So I think he probably wanted to get his boys to get an idea of what it would be like to play on a big court in front of a huge crowd.
They were the first team west of the Mississippi to play in Madison Square Garden, and the New York press, and indeed the national press, just went wild when they saw the dunk for the first time.
They introduced publicly the dunk and did that in New York, not primarily in games, but in exhibitions, and that was, so I'm told, to intimidate the other side.
And this is where the New York Times sports writer coined the phrase dunking the ball, much as you would dunk a donut into your coffee. And hence, this type of shot was named the dunk from a New York sports writer watching the McPherson players warm up. One of their main adversaries were the Universal Picture Universals, and this was a team in the AAU League. They happened to be from Hollywood, California, and they were also in the business of promoting their sponsor's product. They couldn't be any different basketball-wise, and they probably couldn't be any different maybe in terms of the industry they were in. So these two different teams, different in technique, different in strategy, they were the 1936 U.S. Olympic basketball team.
They almost didn't go. They didn't have the money to go. The Olympic Committee had great plans, but the tournament didn't make the kind of money that they thought it would, and so players were getting there by hook and crook.
So what happened in McPherson, Kansas, is the town pulled together in kind of small town American style. They had some raffles, they had charity events, and people reached in their pockets for a dollar or maybe a quarter or whatever they had in the middle of the Depression. They weren't going to not have their hometown heroes not get to Berlin.
On July 8, 1936, the McPherson Globe Refiners packed 6 tall basketball players, a coach, 2 wives, and a child into 2 cars and headed for New York City. They knew this was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and they would return to Kansas as Olympians. But did the team have what it took to bring home a gold medal?
The whole Olympic team went over on the USS Manhattan. So you have the whole group of the Olympians going over there. So they got to mingle with all these people. The only trouble was they didn't have any practice facilities. And so they talked about how they would go out on the boat and try and, you know, do some passing drills and dribbling drills and that sort of thing. But the wind sometimes would catch the ball and blow it off the boat. So they probably didn't get a whole lot of practice going over.
He gained, I think, 10 to 12 pounds on the ship because they could just... And in Olympic Village as well, they could eat as much as they wanted. And most of the guys, I think, gained about 5 pounds, he said.
Hitler, through Goebbels, who was his propaganda chief, saw that it would be a great propaganda coup if they could win, that is, Germany would win the Olympics and prove that the Aryan race was superior. So we had between 1933 and 1936 a lot of Nazi takeover of the German culture, including the discrimination against Jews.
One thing he did talk about when he was over there was, you know, he was 3 feet from Hitler, which he didn't know was that big of a deal until, you know, years later. He said if he had known then what was going to happen, he would have jumped him right there.
I wish he had.
It always kind of gives me the heebie-jeebies just thinking about that.
There wasn't anything that they saw there that was really true because it was all being put on for show.
What did they have when they got to Berlin? What they found was quite shocking to them because they had to play with basically a very lightweight volleyball. And this volleyball wouldn't bounce right. It didn't have the texture, the dimples, the good American basketballs had in the mid-1930s. But the biggest change they weren't used to was playing out of doors.
Only a person who had no knowledge and a great ego would envision a basketball court with a concrete edge standing up above the clay court, because that's just a situation of disaster. The clay courts, they knew it was not going to work, but Hitler was not going to change, and the Olympic Committee was not going to change because they didn't want to ruffle anybody's feathers. And playing on the dirt, sliding on the clay, was just totally a nightmare.
And it seems quite contrary, it seems impossible today, but the first Olympic gold medal game, August 14, 1936, between the United States and Canada, was contested in a rainstorm where perhaps 2 inches of rain fell on the proceedings. It took the effect of being a bath basin. So as the rain came down, there was no provision for draining.
Actually, it was such a muddy, slick condition that they played the first half on one court and they moved over to another court to play the second half. The court that we were supposed to play on originally was a sunken court, and it had 6 inches of water on it. So we had to play, actually it was played on the practice courts.
Impossible conditions, and that explains easily why the final score was U.S. 19, Canada 8.
It was a triumphant moment when Bill Wheatley, a farm boy from Gypsum, Kansas, received the first Olympic gold medal in basketball for the American team.
But it was absolutely fantastic. It makes me shudder every time I think about it. Playing that national anthem, and you walk up on that top stand and hand you that gold medal.
That was probably each one of them's greatest memory. And I went back to the 74 reunion, and you talk to those old ball players, and they still can relive it.
Our basketball heritage, our basketball tradition here in McPherson, we need to keep that alive.
It just carried on, from the 30s to the 40s on to today. And if you drive down any street in McPherson or McPherson County, invariably you'll see basketball goals in the driveway. And it doesn't matter what time of the year it is, there's kids out playing winter, spring, summer, or fall. They're out working on their game, or you can go to the YMCA and you'll see kids playing year-round. It's something that, I think kids grow up with. They go to the games at a young age. They want to be bullpups and bulldogs and tigers and swedes and wildcats or whatever someday. And, they're just brought up on it. The Refiner legacy will always live on.
Well, we think that the younger generation ought to know that this is the roots that started way back there, that it was very important.
It's just a wonderful story, a great story. It's a story of hard work, determination. Even in the midst of an economic situation like the Great Depression,
if we can chronicle the story, we'll have the opportunity to, maybe 50 years from now, look back and say, this really was a big deal. But how that story is going to end up and how it's going to be told is still yet to be written.
The McPherson Globe Refinery basketball team proved to the world that big dreams are worth pursuing. Their story says something to us all about not letting go of our passion, whatever that may be. There is a champion in all of us, just waiting to make a slam dunk.
I'm no millionaire, but I'm not the type to care, 'cause I've got a pocket full of dreams. It's my universe, even with an empty purse, 'cause I've got a pocket full of dreams. I wouldn't take the wealth on Wall Street for a road where nature trots. And I calculate that I am worth my weight in gold and rods. Lucky, lucky me, I can live in luxury, 'cause I've got a pocket full of dreams. Lucky, lucky me, I can live in luxury, 'cause I've got a pocket full of dreams. Thank you.